Our objective in producing this documentary is to get a full investigation into noises that have been recorded coming from somewhere underneath the ground behind Sophie and Nell's in Ammanford. This matter has been reported to Dufford Powers Police, and we will share the details of what happened in this documentary. Recordings have been made in our property by four different teams. The last team were given a key to the property and asked to change the locks before making any recordings. Those people have the only keys to the property. In 2020, we experimented with acoustic sonar to see if we could locate tunnels or chambers. The results were impressive, and we released a video on YouTube that showed a light source coming from behind a solid wall. Shortly afterwards, we had a phone call from Gareth Turk Edwards, one of the owners of Sophie & Nails. Although he'd listened to the noises, he did not seem concerned by them, but he did want to know where the light was coming from, so I told him. And shortly afterwards, Sophie & Nails closed for a day and rescheduled their appointments. There was another part to Gareth's phone call that I chose not to share with anybody until now. Our suspicions were aroused simply because he showed no concern for the screaming, but wanted detailed information about the sonar results. We decided to give him the location of an entrance that we'd found, and made a video of the area. In his call, which I'll play you in a minute, he seemed to be fishing for information. Have a listen, see what you think. Gareth asked me if I actually had found an entrance to the tunnels, and if I knew where it was. Now, the next video shows the rear gardens of 22 College Street prior to Gareth's phone call.
You say maybe have you found entrances, or you've kind of worked out where they might be?
Well, I mean, you've got the hole with the light shining through, but it is accurate because that's how we found the hole.
Right. These tunnels, I mean, have they given any... Where do they run? How far would you say? Have you got any info on that?
They go from the back of the building, well, they go from the side of the building to what appears to be underneath your bit, somewhere across the front, and there appears to be two parallel ones.
When you see the tunnels, are we talking of just enough to walk upright and we, like a square as wide as they are tall, or are they single chat, or how accurate is this, the sonar thing? What are we getting on it?
Right, the sonar is accurate in as much as it'll tell you depth. I know the depth of the base, but I don't know how high the tunnel is. You can see people, you can see a person anyway, going through it, yes you can, but you can't tell whether it's a tunnel that they've crawled through or a tunnel that they're walking through.
So you say there's two, but I mean, where are they getting in? Where do you think they're getting in?
They seem to be getting in next door.
So it's coming in from 22?
Yeah, appears to be.
But where are they? I mean, surely, as in, and then via the front door of 22, or, you know, how are they? So you see, they're getting into the tunnel from 22, but how
is it? It's not 22 necessarily, it's the rear garden, it's the back bit of 22.
The next video shows the rear garden of 22 College Street after Gareth's phone call. It can easily be seen in the video of the rear garden that it was badly overgrown, even though the property's been up for sale for around 2 years. A large part of the clearing up in that garden would have been the cutting down of the overgrowth and the brambles and the like. There were around 50 bags left by the side of the property after that job was completed. I'm told they contain mostly rubble. The question is, where did all that rubble come from?
Now we're going to come on to the most disturbing sounds, and I'm just asking, like, if anyone is of a nervous disposition, you might not want to listen to the next part. Okay, I'm now going to play what sounds like human screaming, and it's children's as well. So have a listen to this first of all. This is the first one.
Thank you.
Somebody suggested to me that this is in the comments section of the Panoi Voice article I wrote, that this is simply the sound of children playing. Well, tone, I mean, it's sometimes children, you know, the sound of children screaming with excitement is different to what I hear there. That sounds like children in distress.
I did my, I think, due diligence when it comes to trying to find alternative explanations for this. But this is going to disturb a lot of listeners, and I'm sorry about that, but the facts are the facts. Children do go missing quite regularly. We know all about Madeleine McCann because her case has been trumpeted in the media. But there was an article written by somebody on UK Column called 80 Maddies a Month, which is basically what it said, that children going missing is actually a very common thing. So it's possible that some of the children that are missing, you might find in that basement.
Don't listen for the next 2 minutes if you feel it's too much for you, and I understand exactly why you'd find this uncomfortable to listen to. The implications of this, and it hasn't been confirmed, and I do hope it is not what it sounds like, but there are people being held in this facility against their will. For reasons, I'm not sure what they might be, but it's obviously a very, very bad thing that's happening.
I said that I could hear a horn honking in the early recordings, and that the noise sounded like it was coming from underneath the floor of my basement. In October 2020, two people recorded some noises at the property. One noise was of a horn followed by its echo. In the following independent recording, a child can be heard saying, "I want to get dressed." During that recording, a horn can be heard honking. There are no residential properties nearby, and the recording of the child was recorded after midnight. The echo suggests the horn is in a tunnel. Because the horn can be heard in the recording of the child, it is possible that the child was either taken into a tunnel or was already in a tunnel. The child asks to get dressed 3 times. Each time the child's voice seems a bit more anxious. A door, or maybe a trap door, can be heard opening. What happened to that child? And what happened to this baby? And what happened to this young person? Who was it that told Gareth to stay out of range? And if you listen to the full 5-hour recording, you can hear someone say to Gareth, "Stay out of range," but he says it to another man and the other man repeats it. So it's quite a long tunnel. Stay out of range of what? On that recording there's some unusual noises. Could those later noises be, well, gunfire? It was on the 8th of August 2018 when I first reported what I considered to be suspicious activity to Dyfed Powys Police. Now, my suspicions were first aroused after hearing a very loud sound, sounded like an air chisel, demolition hammer, something like that, coming from an empty rundown property that was next door. Now, at the beginning, I just thought, yeah, they're just renovating the property. And the noises sounded like an air chisel or a demolition hammer to me. Now, the noises would often start as early as 7 o'clock on a Sunday morning, and they'd go on for most of the day. Those noises could be heard over a long period of time, normally on a Sunday, but sometimes it was during the week as well. Because at the time, I joked with Christine that they were tunnelling under the road to the bank, that's what it sounded like. On one of those occasions, the noises become really loud. It sounded like someone was trying to break through solid rock. Now, if you've ever tried to break through solid rock, you'll know what I mean. Now, on one occasion, the vibration was so strong that the alleyway was actually shaking and cracks appeared in it. Now, cracks also appeared in the sidewalls of both 20 and 22 College Street. Those vibrations also damaged a wall at 24 College Street. Now, I tried to discuss matters with the people next door, but it was ignored. So I asked the surveyor to inspect the damage to see how bad the damage actually was. This is the surveyor's report, and he says this: on the balance of probability of the damage has been caused by construction work carried out at 22 College Street, as described by the owner of number 20 College Street, and as set out in the letter of John Francis dated the 28th of February 2018. Actually, there were two letters from John Francis, but I think he only saw the one.
Sometimes we do not hear anything for months. Then we hear the drilling for days, so the work carried out was very irregular. The owner denies any work is being carried out. I have put my hand on the wall. I have felt vibration, which I believe was caused by the drilling. This has been ongoing over the years. If I was on the telephone, I was finding it difficult to concentrate. The noise was high-pitched. We confirm that the work being carried out at 22 College Street has also caused damage to our property at 24 College Street. Myself and other staff members have heard drilling.
Now that's the side wall of Sophia Nails, and you can just see the crack in the wall. To see how deep that crack actually ran, I got some cable ties, and you can see they're 20 centimetres long, which I think is about 8 inches. That's the side wall where those cable ties in, and you can see in some areas they go all the way in, suggesting that the pillar has gone all the way through. That's the side wall of 22 College Street. Now what would happen was you'd get the vibration and cracks would appear. You can see the render's really old, so some of it is down to that. But when the vibration happened, it would fall out. And the man from next door would come, and he'd clean it out, and he'd fill the crack back in again. And that's just another part of the wall. You can see where the cracks have appeared, and he's just filled them in again. Sometimes quite large bits of the plaster would fall off, and again, he'd just fill them in. But you can see there, that's quite a large chunk that's come off. And that's the side of the size door. All of the plaster fell away in that thing, and that's how he left it. Now that's the alleyway between the properties. Now you can see the ceiling in the alleyway between the properties is badly cracked. That's partially down to the old, it's not plaster, it's something like plaster, cracking. But when it was vibrating, it started to fall out. And you can see the grey is the old plaster, and the white is where it's just filled over it. But you can see in the bottom right hand corner, it's just starting to drop out again. Now this is a path that's been deliberately cut out from the back of the old Citizens Advice Bureau, and it leads to the side of a chapel. As you go through that cutout and round the side of the chapel, you can see two wooden staves leaning on the wall of the chapel. Those staves are similar to ones seen later leaning against the side wall of 22 College Street. And there are the staves against the side wall of 22 College Street. The photo shows one, but there was actually two. There was one the one day, and the following day there was a second one. The police also had the results of my tests that I'd done available to them. They had all my recordings available to them if they'd wanted them. They could have gone into my house and they could have inspected inside. But what did the police do in respect of the report I made? Absolutely nothing. It was in desperation that I sent my report to other police stations. One of them, the Avon and Somerset Police Force, sent my report to Duffy Powers Police, and then the police started what they refer to as an investigation. Now, it was in October 2018 an investigation was launched. It was assigned to PC Tom Draycott, he was the officer in charge, and a PCSO, Alex Muller. Now, even though those officers knew we were forced out of our house and we were living in a van, they did not update us until the 31st of December 2018. Now, those officers were aware that we had nowhere to live but our van. We spent that Christmas in our van. This documentary is made in the back of our van, in a supermarket car park. Today is the 21st of December 2020. Soon it will be our third Christmas spent in our van. What follows next is what the officer in charge, PC Tom Draycott, wrote in his email update of the 30th of December 2018. And he writes, in relation to 22 College Street, on Friday the 23rd of November 2018, I was able to gain full access to 22 College Street and made my way throughout the whole building. What PC Tom Draycott actually did was to phone the owners of the property next door and ask for an appointment to view inside the property.
I was just wondering, did that policeman Alex come to see you in the end? I was just wondering, did that policeman Alex come to see you in the end?
He did come in here, yes. He's, and I've seen them outside your property a couple of times yesterday and the day before. Yeah, they've been there. They were, I think they're going to make an appointment with the house next door to go in and have a look.
Now, Tom says he entered the property on the 23rd of November 2018. That's around 16 weeks after I first reported the matter to Duffy Powers Police, and around 6 weeks after the investigation started. And Tom writes again, I can confirm to you that the building is an empty shell, which has been fully refurbished.
He has had a good look around for quite a while in there. I don't think there were any issues, to be honest.
It's been so long, I wouldn't have expected there to be anything in there anyway. From the photographs that we've got, there does look like there's a big old safe in there.
He did mention something, but I can't recall it, but you think he's had a look at that, didn't you?
That's just a picture of the other side of the door. And you can see those hook things hanging up at the top. I've got no idea what they are, but you can generally see that that's not refurbished. Although the property has been given a coat of white paint on the outside, it is unfinished on the inside. Hooks like this one in the photo can be seen in many of the estate agent's photos. And here's the interesting thing, I've no idea what they are. So if anybody does know, can you let me know? The insides of the doors haven't been painted. And that's a close-up of the door that you've just seen. You can see, well, you wouldn't expect it in the house that you were about to buy. That's what the property looks like from outside in the estate agent's advert. Now in this one you can see not only the hook, you can see the condition of the door, and you can see what appears to be a green safe in the left-hand side. That's a close-up of part of the front door. You can see a plastic sheet that's been nailed over it. And that shows the letterbox. I don't know if you can make it out, but that's a piece of wood that's been nailed over the letterbox on. That's what I've done, is I've put the two doors next to each other. The one on the left-hand side is the front door that's been repainted, and on the right-hand side is what it looks like on the inside. Now, I'm surprised that Tom didn't mention the fact that the front window's got a big plastic sheet on it, and that's the plastic sheet clipped in place. Wouldn't you think if somebody was trying to sell a house, they'd want people to see inside it? That's an old picture of the house. I'm not sure of the date, but it goes back to about 2010. And if you look at it, you can see a plastic sheet in those photos as well. And there's a close-up of it just to show you the plastic sheet, really. Now, Tom says, nor was there any signs to show that any form of large or unusual machinery had ever been used at this address. Now, one of our supporters looked at those BGS photos carefully, and he said there's a red staining that could be seen that looked like light machine oil over some of the boards. The supporter went on to say it looked like something heavy had been dragged over the floorboards, and that the layout of the floorboards were unusual. And Tom says, refurbishment has clearly taken place to the building. However, no large or heavy machinery was used, simply handheld tools. Now, why does Tom state this as if it was a fact that he knew, instead of saying, the owners state no large or heavy machinery is used, simply handheld tools? What he actually said was, refurbishment had clearly taken place on the building. However, no large or heavy machinery was used, simply handheld tools. You see how he says it as a fact? The lady in John Francis' estate agents says that she and her staff had heard the loud machine noises. That's the drilling, or the air chiselling, or call it what you will. And now, if we presume there are three members of staff, so the lady that spoke and three members of staff, that's six people when you include me and Christine that have said loud noises were heard, and that on top of that, the damage could be clearly seen. And Tom Draycott says the estate agent, John Francis, has also been spoken to. And that was it. That was all Tom said about John Francis' estate agents. No mention of what they would have told him. Tom says, in relation to Ammanford Park, the old Citizens Advice Bureau and the chapel, PCSO, Mullock and a colleague have attended all three locations. But what Tom doesn't mention in his report is the cutaway that has been deliberately cut to give access to the chapel, or the wooden staves lying against the side of the wall. And Tom writes, the 34 noises that you describe in your letter appear to be general background noises, which would be expected to be heard within your town centre and in around your home address. However, Tom could not have known what the noises were, as he didn't listen to a single recording. Now, we had reported that strong chemical gas had been introduced into our house. We ended up in accident and emergency, and we phoned 999 at the time, and we have a crime reference number. Given the seriousness of the situation, Tom applied the latest forensic test known as the sniff test. This is what Tom says. Whilst at the address in around 22 College Street, I personally couldn't smell anything gas-like or out of the ordinary. But we had stated that chemical gas was introduced into our house, so why is it that Tom never went inside? Why is it that Duffield Powers Police refused to go inside that house and test it for chemical residues, even though three independent tests have been carried out that indicate there is residue, and the tests indicate that the residue is that of MDMA manufacture? Back in 2018, I used an explosive gas meter to test if there was gas in the house. I walked it across the flat area and up into the loft. As it was going across the flat area, the beeps were getting more. Now, this unit has to be calibrated before you use it. It doesn't beep at all if there's no gas present. And as you take it up the stairs, it beeps more and more. Now, when I did it, when I got to the loft and got into the loft, it was going off the scale. It was almost one continual beep. Anyway, somebody else went back and done it, and this is what they've got. And as soon as it started beeping and started getting faster, yeah, they came out. So they've only recorded a short bit where they were going across the flat towards the loft area. They've only recorded a short bit where they were going from the flat towards the loft area and then turned it off. I think it shows the presence of gas. It also throws into question the following news article. Now, this article goes back to 6th of June 2007. It says this. Arson attack predicted by office owner's family. The arson attack on the Gwaley office in Ammanford was not unexpected, it's been claimed. Now, to give you a bit of perspective, Gwaley office in Ammanford then became Heavenly Nails, and after that it became Sophia Nails. And when I bought the property, 20 College Street, the rear bit, it was fire damaged. The offices have closed. And the story goes on. Jane John, whose father owns the office, says it was a case of, I told you so. Mrs. John said she'd been urging Carmarthenshire Council to secure an adjoining flat and attached house to stop using the property as a meeting place. But Mrs. John said this has not been done, and youngsters have been using the property to store stolen goods. I've asked the council's public protection department to serve an enforcement notice on the owner of the house to secure the building, says Mrs. John of Tiradale. But their efforts were not adequate, and youths were able to get in and out of the building. Officers did a land registry search to find out who the present owner was, and said that they would serve a notice on him to maintain the property. If he did not do this, then they said they'd do it themselves and charge him. But all they did was put up MDF boards, which my 8-year-old daughter would probably be able to break through. Mother of one said the offices had been gutted by the fire which started in the front bedroom. Her father, John Edwards, is now faced with a repair bill for thousands of pounds. I've been informed by the police that youths had access to the flat for many months, said Mrs. John. In October, I spoke to Public Protection and expressed my concerns about the safety of the site. I told the council at the time that youths could damage the property and could even start a fire. Now that's happened, will they do something? Now, after knowing there was explosive gas in the house, isn't it much more likely that the actual cause of the fire was that explosive gas? To my mind, the news article raises some questions. The first is this. How would you know stolen goods have been stored at the property? How would you know that the fire started in the first floor bedroom? And in the article it mentions that the property had been secured by MDF boards. Then how could children have got in? I mean, when I bought that property, it was secured by MDF boards. I had to actually take the MDF boards on down to get in. In fact, it was me and my son that had to remove those boards. Well, an MDF board, they're not actually MDF, it was a type of chipboard. It was a solid, thick, heavy chipboard. And we found it quite a task to remove it. Thanks for listening. Now here's a drug test that we done in September 2020. When the September 2020 recordings were made, the person who made them kindly collected my photo albums for me. When we started looking through the photos, we started to cough. Our throats were sore and our eyes were starting to water. And we just looked at each other. So we cut up some of the photos and albums and we soaked them in water. We tested plain water, then we tested the water with the bits cut up. And we left them both to soak for about 3 days. And there's the result of the test. You can see the left-hand side one. Positive test, that was the one with the bits. And the right-hand test, where the two bars are still both, that's the negative test, that was the plain water. Now that's the third positive test that's been carried out in that property. That's one in 2018, an independent one in 2019, and this one. This test, and the previous combustible gas test, makes me think something's still going on. This is the police raid that was Operation Violet Panama.
As a result of the operation, 24 people have been arrested and 20 of those, having been found guilty, are now starting substantial custodial sentences.
One of the people convicted in that case was Trang Phan Tran. Trang Phan Tran is the leasehold owner of Sophia Nails in Ammanford, and she's the leasehold owner until 2021. And there's a copy of the title deed. Operation Violet Panama was also responsible for the jailing of Quang Lam of Clonethley. Quang Fang Lam was the leaseholder of Heaven Nails in Clonethley. Yes, he had a nail bar as well. And there's a copy of the title deed. Now, a man named Viet Nguyen left a review for Sophia Nails. And there is the review. Viet Nguyen is a man, so they're obviously not his pictures, but that's the review. Now, I know someone called Viet Nguyen had mail delivered to Sophia Nails because they put it through my letterbox by mistake, and I'd see it, and I'd take it and pass it into them. Now, could it be the same man who appears in this court case?
Two women and a man have been sentenced for enforced labour and exploitation offences after a police investigation into nail bars across the country.
Today, three people were sentenced for offences under the Modern Slavery Act. Hung Tu Huynh, known as Jenny, ran the nail bar in Bath and was sentenced to 5 years in prison on two counts of conspiracy under the Act. Another couple who ran a nail bar in Burton-on-Trent, which exploited young women too, were also sentenced. Viet Hang Huynh, known as Ken, was given 4 years in prison for two counts of conspiracy, and his partner, Zhang Hung Chen, known as Susan, received a 2-year suspended sentence for one count of conspiracy.
The judge described the trio jailed today as highly devious, dishonest and manipulative.
The freehold owners are Sophia Nails and Gareth Edwards and his sister Jane John. Now Gareth's known locally as Gareth Turk Edwards because he comes from Clinethley. Gareth says Trank has been nothing to do with the business since 2017. This is what he actually said to me.
Like the son has been out of the picture for 3 years.
Gareth's sister Jane says that Trang has been nothing to do with the business since 2015. And there's a post that Jane put up. It says, the lady named as leaseholder of Sophia Nails is false information. Trang was the leaseholder of Heavenly Nails and assigned the lease to new tenants in 2015. She has had no connection to the business at 20 Coyle Street for 5 years. Trang is the registered leaseholder of the shop premises of 20 Coyle Street until 2021. Now, Gareth and Jane do not dispute the fact that new staff were employed when the business became Sophia Nails. Gareth told me that the person who took over the shop from Trang was a guy called Tom, and he was still at the shop. This is what Gareth said.
But, Tom is definitely someone that is still there.
Gareth said he'd spoken with Tom recently.
Yeah, it is, because I spoke with Tom, about two, 3 weeks ago.
Now, I noticed a review had been left for Sophia Nails, which suggested that the staff had been changed. So I told Gareth about it.
Me? Walk through the doors of Sophia Nails in Ammanford ever again? The place has gone to the dogs since it's changed hands.
Now, I think it's reasonable to suggest that Gareth would have actually known that the staff had changed. Trang Thang Tran left a post on the Sophia Nails Facebook page on the 15th of September, 2020. Sophia Nails Ammanford. We would like to thank all our lovely customers for their continued support over the past 10 years. Now, it must have been posted by Trang Thang Tran. She's the only one that's been there for 10 years. I've discovered a few things that link the three properties, number 18, 20 and 22 College Street. In one of the recordings, a Turkish man can be heard talking at the back door of 20 College Street. He's talking to another man and he's talking about a court case against me. He says he thinks I'll go bankrupt and that my property will probably be added to what he described as his bit. Now it's 11 o'clock at night. One man says to the other man, are you sure this is the right place? The other man says, yes, yes, yes. They knock on a door and a door opens. As they go in, they seem to go downstairs. Now I've seen a plans for both those properties and I've been inside both those properties. There aren't any stairs behind those doors. Now I recognised that voice as soon as I heard it. I played it to a few other people to see what they thought, without telling them who I thought it was. Everyone was of the same opinion. One of the men speaking was the man who used to run the Amateur Fish Bar, Karen or Carlin or something like that, but most people call him Camille. Now I used to speak with him fairly regularly and once gave him a lift to his brother's fast food shop, the King Kebab Shop in Droitwich. I'd know that voice anywhere. I noticed that the Ammanford Fish Bar has recently changed hands. Another link is a Turkish man known as Mustafa bin Boger. He used to run the shop known as the Southern Fried Chicken Shop at 18 College Street before it became the Ammanford Fish Bar. And the clip there, 15th of November 2011, the current premise license holder Mustafa bin Boger has been arrested on an international arrest warrant. Now the picture is of the King Kebab Burger, 39 on Bursley Street in Droitwich. That's Camille's brother's shop. Interestingly, Mustafa bin Boger used to have a shop by the same name, but that was in the High Street in Stamford, I think. I've seen Mustafa bin Boger on three occasions. On one occasion, he unlocked the door, he had the keys, at 22 College Street. He and four other men all went inside. At the time, I thought perhaps he just could open a fast food shop there. Now, on another occasion, I saw Mustafa bin Boger going to 22 College Street and did another bloke. One of the current owners of 22 College Street is Asli Berner-Jones, and she's also from Turkey. The other owner is Lawrence Lewis-Jones, who once told me that he went to school with one of the owners of 20 College Street. Her name is Jane John. On one occasion, when I spoke to Lawrence, and he said he was going to put the property up for sale, which is years ago now, he said to me that he won't see anything out of it. He said he might get a few beers out of it. It was the way he used the words, he might get a few beers out of it, as if it was actually somebody else's property. Jane John once sent me a letter, and I kept it. I've got a habit of keeping things that are just unusual, and it's just an odd letter. Now, it's signed by Jane, Gareth and Simon, and it simply bans me from any properties that they own, and anybody that's associated with me, colleagues, friends, family, from any properties they own now, or in the future. And see, it didn't make any sense, so I just happened to keep it. But now I think about it, the Turkish guys mentioned properties. Laura says the money goes back into property, and Jane seems to suggest that she's going to get property in the future. The other link I could think of is crime. The leaseholder of Sophia Nails is Trang Fang Trang, who was convicted for her part in 15 illicit drug factories in Wales. In an article in Metro, it states that Mustafa Bimboga was convicted of rape at gunpoint and child molestation. That's a BBC article. It says, Vietnamese gang leaders jailed over £6 million cannabis haul. And that's the 27th of September 2019. And there's the title deed of Trang Fang Trang, and it just shows that she's the leaseholder of the shop known as Sophia Nails until 2021. And there's the Metro article. That was written on the 17th of November in 2011 by someone called Joel Taylor. And Joel states, armed rapist Mustafa Bimboga fled Turkey to start a new life running a fast food takeaway in Wales. The fugitive fled his homeland in Turkey 18 years ago after being convicted of rape and attempted child molestation. Article in the Sun. Foreign rape fiend given UK passport. And that's an article on the 3rd of January 2011. A foreign rapist on the run in the UK for 18 years was given a British passport. Kebab shop owner Mustafa Bimboga, 47, got wed and became a UK citizen despite raping a woman at gunpoint in Turkey in 1991. He fled here a year later and he got his passport in 2002. Home Office sources said they did not know about Bimboga's crimes because he was not convicted in his absence of rape and kidnap until 2005. He was arrested in Stamford Hill, North London last month on suspicion of blackmail. The Met's extradition unit moved in after finding he was a wanted man. Here's a Mustafa Bimboga that's registered at the company's house. Now, he has two appointments, so he's got two limited companies, and his date of birth is January 1963. So I'm not saying it's the same Mustafa Bimboga, but if it isn't, they've got the same age. Now this shows that Mustafa Bimboga, it gives his address, and it's in Stamford Hill in London, which is the same as the newspaper report said. So same name, Stamford Hill in London, that's the same, same date of birth. Now the date he was appointed is interesting, 12th of May 2014. So if it is the same man, and he was deported to Turkey, he didn't serve 12 years or anywhere near it. Here's an article in The Guardian, written on Thursday 23rd July 2015. So that's after Mustafa Bimboga seems to be back in the country. Ecstasy and LSD use reaches a new high among young people. I don't know why the word's missing. And it goes on, the use of ecstasy and LSD among young adults has spiked over the past 2 years, with survey results indicating that numbers taking the drugs in the past 12 months are up 84 and 175% respectively. And now I've put that article in simply because the three tests done in my house all indicated ecstasy. Now I tried to report Lawrence Lewis Jones, co-owner of 22 College Street, after he submitted a document to a civil court and claimed a fee remission. He also submitted to the court that he earned £200 a day as a builder, and in any event has assets which would mean that he was not eligible for a fee remission. And there's his application, and you can clearly see the help with fee reference number on the top, and there's his name on the claim. This is from the government site. It says, getting help paying court and tribunal fees. You might be able to get money off your court or tribunal fees if you have little or no savings, or on certain benefits, or have a low income. Whether you're eligible depends on what savings you have, what benefits you're on, and your income. Savings. You need to have less than £3,000 in savings and investments if you're under 61. You can have up to £16,000 if your fee is between £1,000 and £10,000 if you and your partner are 61 or over. Well, he's not over 61. And there's a copy of the title deed showing that he's a proprietor, together with Asley Bernard Jones, of the property at 22 College Street. That property is currently on the market at £250,000. There's no mortgage on it, I've checked the title deed, and recently turned down an offer of £225,000. It's not like you can say he hasn't got assets. I don't know how many houses Lawrence and Asley own, but I do know they own another one at 19 Clandilo Road, Clanderby. And that's it there, it's the one with the yellow arrow. And there's a copy of the title deed, and again it says proprietor Lawrence Lewis Jones and Ashley Bernard Jones. Now there's an interesting thing about that house. Like the one in College Street, you can't see through all the windows. But there's another interesting thing as well. At the rear of the house to the left-hand side of that property, there's a swimming pool. It's an enclosed swimming pool, I know I've been there. Knowing what I know now about 22 College Street, I'm wondering if the purpose of that swimming pool and all that water is to flush the drain out, like I believe it is at 22 College Street. Lawrence Lewis Jones and Asley Bernard Jones submitted a document to a court that contained a statement that they knew to be untrue. There is that statement, together with some notes I made at the time. It says, in the fully pleaded defence of, and I blacked it out, and blacked it out, that was submitted to the County Court on the 14th of June 2018, the following statement appeared at the end. I reported all these incidents to South Wales Police as harassment, and I've been informed that Mr. Tait was spoken to by DC Jones. Now that statement's completely untrue. And if you check the dates, that's why I say that when PC Matthew Jones came round to my house in July 2018 and gave me that warning that I was harassing as the Bernard Jones, it was to cover up that untrue statement they submitted to the court. That's just a clip I took off the internet. It tells you what perjury is. Perjury is the willful giving of false testimony under oath or affirmation before a competent tribunal upon a point material to a legal inquiry. When I removed the blackout from the record of the alleged offences, I could read what the supervising officers had written regarding the alleged offences. In that report was the following comment from a supervising officer. Here's Police Sergeant 1095 Gavin Phillips. It says, investigation update, 23rd of October 2018. And the comment is, the caller only wanted words of advice. The official police record shows that there was never an official complaint made. So who was it that authorised two policemen to come round to my house? Come to that, who authorised two policemen to return to my house on another occasion and sit me in the back of a police car for everyone to see in the main street of Ammanford for a good 15 minutes or so? While I was in that police car, I was told I had to attend a voluntary interview or I would be arrested. I requested the CCTV footage from inside the police car, footage from the officers' body-worn cameras and copies of the officers' notebooks. I did not receive anything. When I queried why I had not received anything, I was told the police were still looking into the matter. Now, that was over a year ago. I travelled to Carmarthen Police Station and explained that I did not want to be interviewed by the same officer. I'll explain my reasons why. The police sergeant that was there said he'd arranged for a different officer to interview me, providing I went to Ammanford Police Station, and I agreed. Now, when I arrived at Ammanford Police Station, the officer that I did not want to be interviewed by was already waiting at the police station, and he was waiting to interview me. Now, fortunately, I'd taken a solicitor with me, and he arranged with the desk sergeant that I'd be interviewed by another police officer. In one document that I removed the blacking out from, the officer has detailed an agreement that he made. And it says, on the Saturday 21st of 7th 2018, it has been agreed with, I've blacked your name out, that she'll be updated in accordance with VCOP, and she would like to be informed via telephone as soon as the pin has been issued upon Mr. Tait. Now that's interesting, because I wasn't interviewed till the 30th of August 2018. That agreement was made between the two of them a full 5 weeks before the interview, and before my side of the events has even been considered. That's part of a letter I received after the interview. It's from my solicitor. It says, Ammanford Police Station, 30th of August 2018. We write further in relation to the allegation of harassment. We can confirm that upon discussion with the police, they have indicated that this has been concluded and they'll take no further action in relation thereto. Now, it's interesting that he says allegation of harassment because the official records show that she only wanted words of advice. But the more I looked at the unblacked out documents, it's the more those police documents revealed. 29th of October, she was informed by text with relation to Mr. Tait. But then it goes on to say her ex-partner, and I blacked his name out, was also spoken with as he visited Ammanford Police Station on the 12th of October. He was also updated fully. Even though it's been recorded that no one ever made a complaint against me, how can someone who has no part in this matter be updated in the case? Following slides show how the person who is recorded as not making a complaint was updated by the police after she's alleged to have asked the police to give me polite words of advice after I sent her a single text message. And that says an update on the 21st of July 2018, and the police officer said that she will be updated in accordance with VCOP and she would like to be informed via telephone as soon as the PIN has been issued upon Mr. Tait. Been updated on the 24th of July 2018, and it says, has been updated and informed that I've spoken to Mr. Tait and arranged for him to attend Ammanford Police Station on the 13th of August following return from annual leave. She's happy with this update. Victim has been made aware that the incident will be progressed on the 20th of August. She has been updated via text in relation to an interview as she's currently in a different country. 24th of September 2018. IP has been updated via text message awaiting supervisor review and whether Mr. Tait will be reported for the offence of harassment. That was the level of contact that the lady received when she allegedly wanted light words of advice to be given to me after I sent her a single text message. When we tried to report what we considered to be serious criminal matters, this is the level of contact that we received.
Byddwch yn ymwybodol fod bob galwad i'r rhif hwn yn cael ei recordio. Please be aware that all calls to this number are recorded.
I'm trying to get through to the station. I'm not getting a reply, and his radio is showing as engaged, so it could be he's on a call. Is there a contact number I can take for you? I'll get a message across to him for him to ring you back.
I'll leave him another message to make sure that he does ring you, okay? I've been trying to get through to him. He's committed on a job at the moment. He's on an immediate inquiry. Can I leave him a message and ask him to ring you as soon as he's back at the station?
Hi, Chrissy. He's currently tied up with something at the minute. What's the best telephone number for yourself? I'll get him to call you back.
Hello there. There's no answer on his radio, so that usually means that they're at a call. If you want me to, I can leave a message, so when he's finished, he can give you a call.
Right, I've tried going through to his radio. I'm not getting an answer with him at the moment, so I don't know if he's committed with something else. Can I leave him a message and ask him to call you back?
There we are. I'll send him a message. I'll ask him to give you a call back as soon as he's free then, okay?
His colleagues have just answered the radio because he's actually dealing with an incident at the moment. He couldn't answer. If I pass on a message, can I get him to call you back?
Oh, he's on a rest day today. He's back in tomorrow at 2 p.m.
There we are. I'll pass the message on for you.
Now, the lady that I sent a text message to was Asley Berner-Jones. She and Lawrence Lewis-Jones are two people that I reported when they submitted an untrue statement to a court. They're also the joint owners of 22 College Street in Ammanford. The police officer who wrote those entries is PC854 Matthew Jones. Now, this is the complaint I originally made. It says, Mr. Tait wishes to make a complaint about the two officers who attended his house on the 3rd of July 2018. He states that they were very forceful and told him over and over again he was harassing Mrs. Asley Jones. The complainant states that at one point PC Davis told him, "We are here to give you a strong warning, Mr. Tait." Mr. Tait said he tried to explain his side of events, but the officers would not listen. He believes the officers were sent by Mrs. Asley Jones in an attempt to cover up a statement which she made to Swansea Civil Justice Centre on the 14th of June 2018, which was untrue. I strongly doubted the authenticity of a document that the police supplied to me in response to the subject access request I had made. Now, my reasons for doubting this document follow, and they're presented in this video with various tests that I made on the document itself. And there's a subject access request that I made. This is a clip from the subject access request itself. It was dated 11th of July 2018 and it says, "Within your SAR, you requested any information relating to your complaints against you during the last year, 2017 to 2018, and specifically to a complaint that led to two officers attending your home address." Then the SAR went on to say, "I've conducted an extensive search across our systems and am unable to find any data relating to your request. All search results have resulted in no information being held or recorded." Now, at that point, I made a complaint to the police. In the reply to my complaint, a document was produced that did actually record the visit, but a document stated the visit took place later in the day than it actually did. Now, the document that I received was heavily redacted, or blacked out if you prefer. That made me think something was wrong, so I looked at the metadata in the document and then went onto the internet to see if I could get the blacking out removed. And just for anybody that's interested, there's a free website and you can just upload a document and you can see the metadata that's in it. And there's the report it produced. Now, if we look at the report closer, there are two extracts that are important because they show the number of revisions made and the total number of characters in the original documents. Now, in the case of this document, there are three revisions that have been made and characters were spaced as 2,794. Then I ended up the document that the police had sent me to see how many characters were in my copy. Now, when the two are compared, it can be seen there are 192 characters missing. In the original version, there's 2,794. Yet in the version that I've got, there's 2,602. Now, in that police report, there are an average of 38 characters to a line. The missing 192 characters is the equivalent of around 5 lines of missing text. Now, removing the blacking out proved to be easy in this case. I highlighted the text that had been blacked out and changed the background colour to no fill. It was that easy. And that shows you what I started with. And that's what it became. It's all gone. Now, further down that police report, we can see the time that the officers say they left, and when they returned. The amount of time between the officers leaving the station and then returning back is just 13 minutes. I requested copies of any video recorded by the officers' body-worn cameras and copies of their notebook entries regarding this incident. I didn't receive anything. I also asked for a copy of the CCTV footage that showed the front of the desk, as it would have showed the officer taking the complaint and him leaving to go and deal with the incident. Again, I didn't receive anything. Let's see if it's possible to actually do what the officers were recorded as doing in the time allowed. Now, first the officer would have had to allocate that incident to himself and his partner. Then he'd have to call his partner and arrange a car. The officer would then have to go from the front desk of Ammanford Police Station, through two doors, and walk across to the car park. He would then have to unlock his car, open the door, and get inside. Let's presume he acts quickly and can do all that in 3 minutes. When he gets back to the station, he has to do it all again, so that's at least 6 minutes he's taken. Now, if we take that 6 minutes from the 30 minutes recorded in the police report, the two officers have 7 minutes left. Now, let's consider the drive to my place, and let's use the route finder to ensure that the timings are accurate. The route finder I used is the AA route finder. I put both addresses in, and I learnt that the drive takes 3 minutes each way, so that's 6 minutes from the round trip. And that's just the pictures of the AA route finder. You can see the route, and you can see how long it takes. Now, if we take that 6 minutes from the 7 minutes the officers had left, that leaves them 1 minute to park the car, walk to my front door, and one of the officers stated that on arriving, himself and his colleague were invited into the building. After knocking at the front door and waiting for it to be opened, they would have needed to walk up this alleyway that you can see in the picture to my house. The officer is documented as having a lengthy discussion with me, and there you can see it in the police report. It says, attended and spoken to Mr. Tait, who was quite animated upon officers explaining the reason for the call. And remember, you know, the reason is that I sent somebody a single text message which has been described as not threatening or harassing, so it's nonsense anyway. And it says, and following a lengthy discussion, officers reasoned with Mr. Tait. Let's not forget the serious incident that is alleged to have warranted an immediate response by two police officers. The police report says that the lady went to an Ammanford police station and complained that she'd received a single text message from me, which in itself is interesting because that lady works and lives in Swansea, which is about 15 miles away. This is a quote from that police report. It says, she just wished for officers to attend the Tait's address and politely ask him not to text her. I strongly doubt the authenticity of that police storm report. Now, what do you think would happen if you went to your local police station and asked them to send two officers to somebody's house just because that person sent you a text? Now, two officers did actually come to my house, but it was earlier in the day. It was just hours after I tried to make a complaint of perjury against the person who said I'd sent her a text message. Now, when those two officers were inside my house, they said they were to give me a strong warning. And they said it over and over and over again. Since I made a complaint, they've both denied saying it. Now, it's important to understand there are no residential buildings nearby. They're all commercial. Many tests have been carried out to see if there could be a credible explanation for the noises that could be heard. All the noises that you'll hear were recorded between 11:30 in the evening and 5:30 the following morning. Now, in total, four different teams, including myself, have been to that property and made recordings. Now, the last one was given a key, was asked to change the locks, they changed the locks, and they kept the keys. They made some recordings, they got the recordings back, and they've still got the keys to today. Now, we placed recorders in both the drains that service the area, on all the old pipework in the building, including two steel girders that strengthen the buildings. Recorders were placed all throughout the building, including the loft area, in an effort to try and find out where the noises were coming from. The noises were clearer in the basement area, in the wall that sits in front of our house and behind Sophia Nails. When I first looked in the basement, I noticed that there were areas where cracks had appeared and black dust had been formed out. Using my hands and a couple of spoons, I removed all the loose material from the cracks. At this point, I could get my hand inside the cracks. I dug out as much as I could using the spoons, then put a vacuum cleaner hose into the holes. I sucked out as much as I could. I had to do it a few times. The vacuum cleaner hose was 1.5 meters long. It went into both holes for the whole length. I mean, the hole could be deeper than that, but the shafts are at least 1.5 meters deep. On some occasions, I placed recorders at the front of the house, the rear of the house, the left-hand side of the house, the right-hand side of the house, and in the basement. On one occasion, I compared the recordings. I could hear the "Why Gareth, Why the Babies Died" on the recorder in the basement, but when I checked the other recordings, it wasn't on them. On another occasion, I placed three recorders across the wall that faced Sophia Nails and fitted shields to them. When I played the recordings back, the noises were different. When I looked at the waveforms, I could see a pattern. Some of the noises that appeared on the first recorder appeared on the second recorder, but 12 minutes later. I listened to recorder one, I could hear a person walking. Yet when I listened to recorder two, the person could still be heard walking, but 12 minutes later. It seemed to me they were walking down a tunnel or whatever, and then back into the second tunnel. The only explanation I could come up with was maybe there were two parallel tunnels running somewhere underneath Sophia Nails and out underneath the road towards the old co-op building. At a later point, I received an email from Simon Bolton. It was on Monday the 1st of July 2009, and it says, I used to be a sound engineer, and I can tell you those voices of the adult female are near, and she's in a room no bigger than 9 foot by 12 foot with a modern ceiling height. Simon went on to say that the female young girl sounds around 7 years old, and reverb-wise, she sounds like she's in a separate room adjacent to the female adult. Simon says the recordings are very consistent and share identical room dynamics in every recording. No ghosts here, he says. This is people being held against their will. Simon says there is a recording where the adult female is knocking on a pipe consistently in a paced, but not Morse type manner. I saw Tom Draker on a different occasion as well. It was Sunday the 6th of January 2019, and we drove out to the property to recover Andrew's car, my son's car. We parked it in the loading bay overnight. Now, the reason we parked it in the loading bay overnight is there's a drain to the left-hand side, and we put a microphone in it, and we'd lowered it down so that's if that's where the noises were coming from. As we got there, we noticed one of the tires was flat. There's nothing really unusual in that. Our tires used to get let down all the time. I went into the house, I got a few bits and pieces, and when I come out, there's a policeman stood there, and it was Tom Draker. When we asked what he was doing there, he said he was there to prevent a breach of the peace. Says the owners of 22 Collis Street were going to arrive at 10 o'clock and remove our front door. I asked him what legal authority he had. PC Draycott told me that they had court paperwork saying that they could remove the front door. Anyway, PC Draycott refused to look at the paperwork that we had. I spoke to Tom Draycott. I said, look, I've got a copy of that paperwork, and he refused to look at it, and he was saying it's a civil matter and he didn't get involved. It seemed a bit odd to me. Anyway, Mr. and Mrs. Jones and another bloke turned up in an old camper van. I asked PC Draycott how he happened to be there, and he told me he'd received a text message from Mr. and Mrs. Jones asking him to attend. So I asked him, well, what, they can just text you and you come out? And he said, oh, we don't do that anymore. It seems to be one rule for them and one rule for me. And what I really don't get is, how is it Tom and the Joneses can turn up at my property to remove property that's mine, and the first thing I knew about it was I happened to be there? Another interesting thing, Andrew's tire was let down, and PC Draycott said he'd check the CCTV. Later he contacted us to say he'd been through all that CCTV, yeah, watched it all night, and he could say clearly, without any problem, that nobody went anywhere near the car. See, we had a microphone in that car, and we beg to differ. Now, our social media sites sometimes get comments. People are free to choose if they want to visit our social media sites, and they're also free to choose if they want to leave a comment. The following comments were left on our social media site. Some were left by Mr. Simon Griffiths. Now, Simon put his email address on his social media site. It was in the public domain for everybody to see. But when I replied to Simon by name, he took down some of his comments that he'd made. Here are the comments of Simon Griffiths and some of the replies from other people. Kushti Griff. Alan Tait, what the hell? Deluded or what? Kushti Griff. Too much time on the hands, I'm guessing, with a bit too much daytime TV for good measure. Kushti Griff. Betty's mine is nowhere near the address, as you know. It's no surprise the police didn't investigate, but you'd imagine they'll be investigating yourself and soon. Police have important work to do. They can't investigate your imagination. Now, if you look at the route map, Betty's mine's about 0.7 miles away, it says 2 minutes. But if you have a look at that drawing, if you were going in a straight line, it'd be less than half a mile. Kushti Griff, could you print off all the info you have, please? A local solicitor is interested in any info you have on paper due to the lack of paper in his office lavatory. Kushti Griff, I know that public opinion thinks it's a comedy of errors. Prove me wrong, go on. And there's this from James Indus. Kushti Griff, you probably have your pink sunglasses on, mate. The real world is full of evil people and things that go on under the radar. Why wouldn't people access tunnels and use them for their own ends? Kushti Griff, I live in Ammanford, and after speaking to many locals, I can't find one who agrees with your thoughts. I'm not being nasty, by the way, just being honest.
Kushti Griff, it's so sad. You would rather gossip with the locals and distract rather than trying to help. That's really sad.
Kushti Griff, there are no noises except for the usual day-to-day street sounds. I'm surprised the police haven't investigated you. Kushti Griff, I'm no doctor, but that's all that's needed here. Not good to waste the efforts of police on overactive minds. And I replied to him, can you explain how overactive minds can record noises coming from underneath the floor of a house?
Kushti Griff, overactive in your view, compassionate and curious in mine. Maybe you haven't been overcome with chemical gas in your home and been privy to the sounds of screaming and crying. Is there a reason you are so keen to discredit this family?
Kushti Griff, your own replies are proof that you have no understanding of psychology whatsoever. Kushti Griff, nothing there. your lies are catching up.
Cushti Griff, why spend so much time attacking them? What's in it for you? They're a lovely couple, and unfortunately, the person who wrote this and the other comments has nothing better to do with his or her time. If they disagree, just move along, innit? Cushti Griff, in what way have they made people's lives bad? These people go out of their way to be kind to people and have done many charitable actions all their lives.
Cushti Griff, if you call these actions kind, then you're deluded. Disgusting, in fact.
Cushti Griff, really? You are disgusted that I'm questioning the possibility of child abuse, human trafficking, and illegal drug production. Suspicious indeed.
Alison's from David Warnock. What are you trying to achieve, mate, coming on here and attacking Alan? Look at the source material. From what I've heard so far, something tells me this is worth looking into. Remember, we're talking about women and children being abused. And from David Warnock. Why would you come here and attack someone who believes that this is happening and spent the last year and all his money trying to uncover the truth? Funnily enough, you're from Ammanford. I hope you haven't come here to try and muddy the water. Is Alan just a little too close to home for comfort? Cushti Griff, prove everything you just typed, then look into the history of their stories. From David Warnock. This is what Alan is trying to do, proving what he has experienced. What would you do if you were hearing women and children in distress? Another one from David Warnock. Alan has nothing to gain from all of this, except potentially freeing some poor people who are in a bad situation. Would you, if hearing a child screaming in the middle of the night outside your house, go and investigate? And this from David Warnock. Keep at it, mate. The truth will come out. And from Cushti Griff. Look, you asked me to go away and I did. Can you leave things go now, please? I prefer to agree to disagree, and I do disagree with your claims. Just being honest. Simon, I've not asked you to go away, nor would I. You and everyone else are welcome to your opinion. I have a theory about some of the work that was carried out at 22 College Street. After hearing what appeared to be automated noises discharging something into the drain that come from 22 College Street overnight, I decided to test the drain. So late one night, I pushed some steel wool into that drain pipe and I recovered it the following morning. And there you can see the steel wool that I pushed up the drain pipe. The property was derelict, nobody was living in there, yet every hour you could hear a flushing noise, and if you look closely you can see the brown sort of gunk that's on there. You can see a dark coloured fatty substance. The noises were regular, once an hour. There was a residue on the steel wool, it was a dark fatty substance. I tested it with a forensic testing kit and the reagents changed colour. And there you can see the reagents and you can see the colours that they've changed to. The man next door put a gully in the alleyway that diverted the rainwater from the roof of 22 College Street past the nearest drain and onto the drain that I'd tested. I think the reason for that gully was to flush out whatever residue was in that drain. Now there's one of the surveyor's photos, so it shows you that's where the downpipe was that's coming from his roof. And you can see in the photo that it runs a metre, maybe in a metre and a half in the left direction. And just in front of that drain to the right, just out of the photo, there's a drain that it could have gone into. And as you can see the other side of the gully, it runs about another 3.5 metres to the drain, and that's the drain that I tested. In the crumbling ceiling of the alleyway, a noise could be heard from time to time that sounded like water flowing through a pipe, but sometimes a dripping noise could be heard at the end as if the process was coming to an end. And then it would repeat itself. There's a picture of the old ceiling as it was. I'm of the opinion that there were parts of an automated machine concealed in that ceiling, perhaps some form of cooling tower, or the long pipes that are connected to a distilling unit. The old ceiling has been replaced, so if there was anything there, it's likely to have been moved. My theory would be easy to test. New ceiling is fixed in place with screws. There are two methods of replacing a ceiling like that. The first is simply to screw new boards over the old ceiling. It's the cheapest and fastest way to do the job. And that's a picture of the new ceiling. If the new boards were taken down and the old ceiling is still present, then my theory is wrong. Now the second way to carry out that job is to remove the old ceiling and then attach the new ceiling. Although time consuming, that would be the way that I would do that job. If my theory is correct, there will be evidence in that ceiling area that something's been there. Perhaps holes will have been cut through the wooden support beams to allow the pipes to connect up, or old supporting brackets, or even screw holes where the screws had been. It would be fairly easy to prove or disprove this part of my theory. When I was at the house, I could smell a strong smell of ammonia from time to time. At the time, I just presumed it was someone cleaning something. I do remember the smell was very strong. Now, four teams of people have been into that property, and two of them mentioned the smell. Both said that they could not smell anything themselves, but when they got home, it was their partner, or in one case, their mother, that said they smelled strongly of something. One said it smelled like bleach, the other said ammonia. Now, testing the drain is also possible. Although the area has probably been very well cleaned, it would be almost impossible to get rid of all the residue. Whatever that stuff is, it was travelled from whatever was connected to the other side of the wall. Now, those connecting pipes are where the residue could be found, at the highest point of those internal pipes that connect the unit to the drain. One of the teams that went to the house checked the temperature. Now, there's no heating in the house, and it's been empty for 2.5 years. Now, that shows the temperature gauge, and you can see it's beside the bathroom, and you can see its proximity to an open window. And that shows you 32 degrees. That seems high to me. This is further down the property, in the front bedroom, and again, 32 degrees. Back in 2018, when I used to live at the property, rubbish would be put out of the back door of Sophia Nails. Now, if I was going to the tip, I'd grab the rubbish and take it up. It was a favour for them, but it was more to keep the alleyway clean. Now, one particular time, I'd come back from Bulgaria. As I'd come past, there was loads of rubbish. It was absolutely everywhere. It must have been about 15 bin bags, something like that. So I decided to take it all up to the tip. I took all their normal black bags, and I picked up the trade waste as well, because there was 3 or 4 bags of that. I wasn't to know what was going to happen next, but when I got to the tip, I started throwing it in. As I picked up one of the pink bags, it came open and something hit my leg. Now, when I looked down, I found 5 bags like the one in the photo, and 5 briquette things that were wrapped in leaves. Now, I've offered them to the police and they weren't interested, but if you look closely at those photos, who throws something away like that? The liquid was about 300 to 330 mils, somewhere around there, and you can see from the bag, it's wrapped in sort of stockinette material, then it's inside another wrap of paper, then it's been wrapped in plastic, then it's got an elastic band around it. Now, I offered this to the police, and they said that, you know, they've got no idea what it was, and they didn't want to take them in, and they said I should throw them away. And there you can see the wrappings. I started to undo it to try and show you it. You can see the stockinette material, you can see the paper that's been wrapped around it, and the liquid that's in there, it's not like water, it's like the liquid you see in a plasma lamp. After taking the rubbish, when I returned back to the property, the guy was waiting for me. He came out and he went absolutely ballistic. What was normally a friendly guy, I've never ever seen him at all angry, was raving. He told me not to take his rubbish again, what had I done with it? He was just intensely angry. Veins on the side of his neck, he was really upset. And his wife, I presume it's his wife anyway, also came out of the shop. And she just looked different. She looked angry, but she looked really concerned as well.
It's Christmas time. There's no need to be afraid.
Okay, stop.
And in our world of plenty,
with his background noise, for God's sake.
December 2019, recordings were made at my house by somebody else. They left the recorders in for 3 days, and there were 4 recorders. As it turned out, one of them, they didn't turn one of them on, so there's actually only 3 lots of recordings. When I listened to those recordings, I was shocked. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. So I reported what I heard to Inspector Mark Davies of Duffy Parish Police. And this is what I wrote to Mark Davies. Dear Mark Davies, a friend of mine placed 3 microphones in my house at 20 College Street, Ammanford. The microphones can record noises and sounds that a human ear cannot always hear, sounds in the distance, etc. I was shocked when I played them back. I could hear a shotgun being discharged repeatedly, followed by what sounds like semi-automatic fire. In one part of the recording, it sounds like the shotgun's discharged and a woman says, "Bastard." Now, my friend left the 3 microphones in that house until the batteries went flat. In total, they were able to make 12 5-hour recordings on each microphone. I'm writing to you to ask the police to fully investigate these matters. Please get back to me if you need any further information. Best regards, Alan. And he writes back to me. Thanks for your email. I can confirm David Powers have had no reports of semi-automatic gunfire or shotgun discharges in the area. Well, I've just reported it. I'm reporting it. Why don't I count? Now, when I explained to him that those noises could not be heard by human ear, he doesn't ask me any further questions. It seems that when I mentioned gunshots and semi-automatic fire, he just doesn't take seriously what I've said, so I emailed him for clarification. And this is what I wrote. Dear Sir, I supplied you with recordings of gunshots. Do the police intend to investigate this matter further? And he replied, Dear Mr. Tait, as I said, we've not had any reports of semi-automatic gunfire or shotgun discharges in the Ammanford area recently. The listening devices your friends have installed could well have picked up noise from miles away, and in the case of semi-automatic weapons, they create substantial noise, and in the absence of any further reports, we will not be investigating any further. But here's the thing. Even if those gunfire noises were miles away, surely they deserve and warrant a proper investigation. Now, semi-automatic weapons, it's true. Semi-automatic weapons of high calibre can be heard quite a long way away. I think the critical point here is the officer doesn't deny that the recordings are of shotguns and semi-automatic weapons. His main reason for not investigating the matter seems to simply to be that the sounds might come from miles away. So I wrote to him, and I said, Dear Mr. Mark Davies, I understand and agree with you. The sounds could be travelling through a tunnel or something similar. As I consider I've reported a crime, will the police kindly get back to me with a prime reference number? And he responded, Dear Mr. Tait, there is no evidence of a crime, and David Powers Police will not be providing you with a crime reference number. I will not be responding to any more emails. If you believe a crime has taken place, you need to report it to 101. Now here's the thing, 101 is a non-emergency number. This is firearms, serious firearms we're talking about. If you remember back to the first documentary, when a lady walked into Ammanford Police Station and stated that I sent her a single text message that was described as not harassing or threatening, 2 officers were immediately dispatched to my house. Yet when I tried to report recordings of shotguns and semi-automatic fire, I'm told there's no evidence of a crime. Anybody that wants to see the letters that have gone between us, I've put a link onto my website. So all you have to do is go to alantaitammanford.co.uk and that's it. That's where it is. A long-serving police officer has been shot dead at Croydon Custody Centre in South London. The male sergeant was shot in the chest before the suspect aimed the firearm on himself, sources have told the BBC. The force's chief said the policing family was deeply shocked and very sad following the death of their officer. She went on to say, I have visited and spoken to our officer's partner together with other colleagues, and we are of course giving the best support we can, she said. My heartfelt condolences go to her, to their family, to his colleagues and his close friends. I add my condolences to them as well. It's a tragic waste of a life. Why should brave police officers face criminals with firearms just because certain police officers do not take credible reports seriously? Inspector Mark Davis says, Mr. Tait, there's no evidence of a crime, and DPP will not be providing a crime reference number. I will not be responding to any more emails. If you believe a crime has been taking place, you need to report it to 101. 101. That's the non-emergency number. I have recordings that sounded like a shotgun being discharged. You can hear people in those recordings sounding like they're being abused. You can hear what might be semi-automatic fire. And this guy says, if you believe a crime's been taking place, you need to report it to 101. Various comments were left on our social media sites that suggested that the sounds that we were hearing might be fireworks. So let's explore that option.
Hi everyone, my name is Alicia Moore. I am a public information officer with the Richmond Police Department. I'm going to tell you how to tell the difference between gunshots and fireworks. Gunshots are very crisp and they have a certain timing or cadence to them. Pop, pop, or pop, pop, pop. Fireworks are very loud, just as gunfire, but they are very sporadic. A lot of crackling, sometimes they echo, and sometimes there's a whistle before the fireworks. So you can see that it kind of sounds very similar. If you close your eyes and imagine like seeing beautiful fireworks, usually you can tell when it's fireworks based on just the cadence alone. Well, we do have our shot spotter activation that's able to determine gunshots from fireworks. They're able to filter that out. So that actually helps our officers a lot, but it's still really vital for the community to work with us and just call 911 and let them know that you heard gunshots.
Now, firework events are normally held outside and generate quite a lot of smoke. By contrast, firearms generate very little smoke. Now, in the next recording, a man can be heard talking, so he must be quite close to the recorder that was in my house. Now, to me, that sounded like someone inserted a magazine into the weapon just before discharging this weapon. I've looped it three times so you can hear it clearly, and then I'll play that clip again. Now here are some examples of weapons that I fired on various ranges. The 9mm one, the pistol that you see, isn't actually the one that I fired, but it gives you a good example of the sound. Now, when I was about 28, two of my friends, Mark and Terry Squans, took me out. Oh, they asked me if I wanted to go clay pigeon shooting. And, you know, I like being around Terry and Mark, so I decided to go out. Oh, it was a Sunday. Now, Terry, that's Mark's father, is into his shotguns. He's always been a bit of a collector. On the day, I'd never fired a shotgun before. Now, I fired a single barrel shotgun, over and under shotgun, side-by-side shotgun. And we were just flinging clay pigeons up and shooting them down. Then Terry bought out one of the weapons that he kept in his collection. And it was a ratchet action shotgun. And that's what I think I can hear. If you listen, I'm going to play you the recording again. If you listen to it, in between what appears to be shots, there's a ratchet action.
Ratchet action.
Now, I heard from Gareth the other day, and Gareth says this. What we could do is me and him meet up, make sure that the nail bar owners and everybody don't know anything about it at all. He'll get a key, and you know, he's quite happy for me to go with him of a night, anytime I choose, into his basement and make a video to show everybody that's nothing going on. No thanks, Gareth. It wasn't the only time that I spoke to Inspector Mark Davies. Today I've received three phone calls out of the blue. Two were from triage nurses. They phoned me up. They told me they worked for the crisis centre at Ammanford, which is a mental health unit, I was later to find out. They asked me, you know, how they contacted where my local services. I explained to them, you know, I haven't got mental health issues. And I asked them, do you want my recordings and will you take a statement off me? I'm not interested. All I got over and over again is, would you know where to go if you got unwell? The implication, time and time again, is that I had mental health issues. Now, one of those calls was in 2018, one was in 2019. Now, I haven't got any mental health issues or problems at all. But here's the thing. Given the seriousness of the allegations that I've tried to make, wouldn't you think that the proper way forward would be to talk to my GP? The GP who is actually, I went to see him. I went to see my GP over this matter, and he wrote me a letter confirming that I'm not under any medication at all for mental health issues. But I suppose the big question is why I got those phone calls, who orchestrated them, and what's the true purpose of them. Anyway, after one of those phone calls, I made a complaint. I had a reply, and it came back from Mark Davies, so I'm just going to read it. It says, Wednesday the 26th of June 2019. Mr. Tait, in response to your email, I can answer the following. Number one. Now, this is my question. What was the information that the police have that prompted the phone call? The reply is this. You made contact with police at Dufford Palace Police yourself, and Storm Report DP 2019-0625-119 was created in response to this. Now, just as a sideline, I asked for a copy of that, and one wasn't forthcoming. Number two. I said, I want the name and the number of the person making the call. The reply was, the officer was PC 657 Sue Knoll, who is our member of our mental health triage team. Three, I said, I want full details of the event that was referred to in June, where it was alleged that I was seen locally. And he replies, you were seen by the crisis team in Ammanford on 4th of June 2019. Storm reference DP-2019-0604-275. Refers. Again, this is something you created via email. Well, there's two storm reports that all I've asked for haven't been forthcoming. Anyway, I made a subject access request, and here's the result. Dear Mr. Tait, thank you for your response. I've now reviewed the storm message referred to and can confirm there is no mention of you being seen by the Ammanford Crisis Team in that record. There is a mention of a visit to a GP in Barry, and you were contacted by our mental health triage team. Now see, there's no way I can disprove this, although they accept now that I never went to the Ammanford Crisis Team. I never went to the GP in Barry either. I mean, I've got a GP, and he's in Ammanford, in Brintegg Surgery. I've no need to go to a GP in Barry. But not only that, how can I disprove it? They won't let me have the storm record, and I'm not going to go around every doctor in Barry. SAR 3. On behalf of Dufford Palace Police, please accept my apologies for this error. I hope that this has now provided you with some reassurance there is no reference in records held by Dufford Palace Police of you being seen by the Ammanford Crisis Centre. On behalf of Dufford Palace Police, please accept my apologies for this error. I hope that this has now provided you with some reassurance there is no reference in records held by Dufford Palace Police of you being seen by the Ammanford Crisis Centre. Now, in a later conversation with the officer that dealt with the SAR, I was told that Inspector Mark Davies headed up the professional standards team. A short video of Down My Alleyway received a privacy complaint, even though nobody was in it and nobody was mentioned in it. So that made me look at it a bit closer. To start off with, I thought it was the hole, because you can just about see the plastic sheet that covers it on the other side. Then I thought it might be the position of the two pipes, because those downpipes both flush the drain that I tested, that tested positive. But then Chris noticed something. It's the red tinge in this photo here. And that reminded me of a previous conversation we had. I once spoke to someone in Barry who knew three police officers. One of the photos that I sent them had, I don't know what it was, it looked to me, I can't find a photo from it. If I do, I'll put it up. It had bits of red tinge in it. It was just, it was around the outside surface of the drain, and I thought it was unusual. I told that person about it, and they showed the police officers. Now that person tells me that it could be the residue of firearms manufacturer. Now I've seen the photo, and I can't see anything in it, but that's what she told me. These are the events that led up to a civil court case between myself and the shop owners in the Swansea Civil Justice Centre. That's lot number 43 in an RH Steel auction. It says, fire damaged, formerly bedsits, 20 College Street, Ammanford, Carmarthenshire, SA183AF. It's described as a mid-terrace property, part of which has been sold off, that's the shop part, now fire damaged and boarded, previously comprising of 6 bedsits and offered for sale with vacant possession. Accommodation, not inspected internally, but prior to fire damage comprised on the ground floor, at the rear, 2 bedsits and a kitchen. On the first floor, 4 bedsits, 2 bathrooms. The property is sold with vacant possession, but with the potential to produce a reasonable income when refurbished and fully let. Tenure is freehold. In this picture, you can see the photo blown up a bit more. Now, the bit we're going to concentrate on is the upper bit, so you can see what appeared to be the fire damage. Notice how the door's already been boarded over. I stood across the road from my house. I used a pair of powerful binoculars and I could clearly see that the net curtains were still hanging in the front left-hand side window. I thought the fire could not have been that severe in the area simply because the net curtains were still hanging. There I've tried to show you with arrows what I could see. If you look at the top of the roof, you can see the tiles are obviously missing. There's obviously damage there. Look at the window on the left, you can just about see the net curtains. And on the right, you can see a blown window. Now, I'd read a news article prior to buying the property, and it said the fire started in the front bedroom. There's the article, and the URL's in the description if anybody wants to read the article. 6th of June 2007, arson attack predicted by office owner's family. And it says, the mother of one said the offices had been gutted by the fire, which started in the front bedroom. Now, there were no internal viewings available, so I went round the back of the property. There's a park to the rear, and from there I was able to use binoculars to have a close look at the roof. Now, in this picture, you can see how wide the roof actually, the damage is. But from the park, yeah, you can't see it. It doesn't look like that because you're lowered down. Now, after buying the property, I realised I'd made a couple of mistakes. Firstly, because the news article said the fire had started in the front bedroom, I thought it had. After inspecting the property internally, I was of the opinion that the seat of the fire seemed to be much further back in the house. And this is a clip from aboutforensics.co.uk. It's quite an interesting site. Establishing the origin of a fire. A vital aspect of the forensic fire investigation is to establish the point of origin of the fire, also known as the seat of the fire. The region in which a fire started will generally burn for a longer amount of time, thus there will be an area with the worst damage. Fires tend to burn upwards, therefore the seat of the fire is likely to be found at a lower point of burn damage. Now, in my opinion, the seat of the fire was in this room, not the front room, and you can see that the boards have actually burnt through. So although the fire is going upwards and it's taken out the roof, it's burnt downwards as well, which tends to suggest that that was a very hot area. The second mistake I'd made was this. I had not allowed for the fact that I was looking up at the hull and not directly onto the hull. When viewed from the park, the hull seemed to be a lot smaller. Fire was at its strongest point, about 5 metres back from the front bedroom. Just have a quick look through the following photos and see what you think. Now you can see the main bit of the roof is just all that needs replacing in that clip. You can see the charred beams. And that shows you the extent of the damage. There's that picture again, just after the other one, so you can see roughly where the holes are in relation to the building. That's a picture of the front of the house just before we started redoing the roof, just scaffolded it up. That's the roof of putting in the main beam. Yeah, I'm not going to bore you with lots of photos in the middle. So there's the roof battens and the felt. Now that's the roof when it was reconstructed and it's completed. Now in the next photo, I'm going to try and show you where I think the fire started. Now the mother of one said the offices had been gutted by the fire which started in the front bedroom. However, after inspecting the property, I think the seat of the fire was not in the front bedroom, but where I've placed the arrow. Prior to buying the property, I researched who was responsible for the repairs. It seemed to me that the shop premises could not trade until the repairs had been carried out, and the flat above the shop could not be used until the repairs had been carried out. I thought a 50-50 share was reasonable. I bought a book that covered this area and found there was a legal precedent that covered this sort of shared repairs. I'll put a link in the YouTube description to it, but the precedent is known as Abhall versus Smee. Well, I went to the auction, I bid for the property, and I won it for £38,000. Afterwards, I spoke to one of the owners of the shop, and we agreed I'd get the repairs done, we'd split the bill 50-50. Their version of events, of course, is that that didn't happen. So, unfortunately, when the repairs were finished, the owner said we never had such agreement, and that's why we ended up in a civil court. Now, these are extracts from the transcript of what the judge said in the court case. The quality's not that great, but, I mean, the document's 10 years old and they do fade. And this is what he said. Clearly a significant dispute in this case is over the responsibility for and the cost of the repair of the roof. Mr. Tait, when he gave evidence, said he took into account that there would have to be money spent on the roof when he purchased the property. He did say that he expected to be able to get a contribution towards the cost of the repairs from the shop owners. Indeed, he goes further than that and alleges that Mrs. John, acting on her father's behalf, as I understand it at the time, agreed to pay one half the cost of the repair. Mrs. John denies that and indeed denies any liability to make any contribution towards the cost of the repair. And he goes on, in correspondence, Mr. Tait referred to previous meetings with Mrs. John, and Mrs. John does not deny, although I'm not sure she entirely accepted it, but she does not deny that there was a conversation in which the figure of £20,000 for the work was mentioned. It is perhaps fair to say, I think, that she and Mr. Edwards were unnecessarily evasive on the point whether they would benefit from the work that was being carried out. It was quite clear they would benefit. They were bound to. They could not have relet the shop until that work had been carried out, or at the least, the roof of the shop made secure and waterproof. Now, during the court case, various counterclaims had been made against me. One concerned a dilapidated toilet that I said had fallen into disrepair and not been used for many years. However, the owners of the shop did have a right of way to walk up the alleyway and use the toilet in times gone by. They still have the right of way, but the toilet was just not capable of being used. Now, that toilet was in that condition when I purchased the property. It was the previous owners and the owners of the shop that allowed the toilet to get into the state it was in. Now, I contacted them, and I asked the shop owners if they wanted to reinstate the toilet and split the bill on a 50-50 basis. I did not receive a reply. So I said that if I did not hear from them, I would get the filthy, unhygienic toilet removed, and I gave them 6 weeks' notice. They did reply, but they said they wanted to keep the toilet, but didn't want any of the expenses, and expected me to refurbish the toilet. And this is what the judge said about that. As to another right-of-way, which is in part along the same path to the right of the premises, but continuing in a straight line to a spot where previously there existed an outside lavatory. The lavatory was demolished by Mr. Tait, apparently in spite of objections by Mrs. John. Mr. Tait's case is he demolished the lavatory because it was simply not used, and in any case it was unfit to be used. Nevertheless, Mrs. Jones asserts that this is interference with her rights over the property. And this again is the judge. The lavatory was not, apparently, in their ownership, so as far as one can tell and must, I think, been in the ownership of Mr. Tait and his predecessors. Mr. Tait's evidence was that the lavatory clearly had not been used for a long time. He would not have known that from his own observations because he'd only just acquired the premises, but clearly he bases it on the state of the lavatory. Mrs. John, in her evidence, refers to a photo which she showed me, and she said that it was in that condition before the fire occurred. If that is right, and this is the only evidence I have, then it's perfectly obvious that the lavatory was not being used and not been used for some time. What is strengthened in that conclusion by the evidence again of Mrs. John, who told me that the shop premises now contained its own lavatory inside the shop. It is unlikely that if there was a lavatory in the premises, that an outside lavatory would be used. And the first bit's the judge again. She says, however, and he's referring to Mrs. John, that the outside lavatory would be used by customers when the shop reopens. I understand her to say that the proposed use of the premises is a nail bar. Now, that's a picture of the nail bar that's there now. At the time, it wasn't going to be Sophia Nails, it was going to be Heavenly Nails. So, the ladies that visited that shop would have been expected to go down the side door, walk down the long alleyway, in all weathers, to use the following toilet. And there it is. I don't know if you can see it clearly, but even the rim is cracked. It was a totally disgusting state that the previous owners of my property and the shop owners as well, in where they just abandoned it, that's how they left it, not me. And this is the judge again. I do not accept those submissions. It seems to me, to all intents and purpose, this lavatory is no longer in use. The remedy I have is to apply a discretionary remedy, and I come to the conclusion that it would be disproportionate if I was to order a restoration of the lavatory, which is out of use for practical purposes, and which is unlikely to be much consequence in the future. As for the question of damages, again, it seems to me, in effect, that defendants have suffered little or no loss by the inability to use the lavatory, which could not have been used, and which was unlikely to be used in the future. So in my judgment, the only proper way of dealing with this is toward nominal damages of one penny in respect of Mr. Tait's removal of the lavatory. Now, they also made a claim against me for a window that had been previously damaged in the original fire, and in any event, had formed part of their insurance claim. This is what was said about it. I do accept the submission made by Mr. Spackman that the breaking of the window was not in the result causative of the loss to Mrs. John and Mr. Edwards. It seems clear that any loss attributable to the breaking of the window was the result of the fire. Now, I consider that my legal team made mistakes when they put together my side of events. several of those mistakes were actually crucial. The first mistake was that the president that I discovered wasn't submitted to the court until the day of the trial, and that appears to be what lost me my costs on that day. Secondly, only a part of the claim for the roof was heard, but my claim had two significant parts, a claim for the roof and a claim for reinstating the ceiling of the shop premises. This is what the judge said finally in that case. Therefore, I conclude that Mrs. John and Mr. Edwards must pay half of the amount towards the roof. Therefore, I conclude that Mrs. John and Mr. Edwards must pay half that amount towards the cost of replacing the roof. That is a figure of £3,750. N16. Now, this has been disputed a few times that I actually won on that day. So there's the court paperwork. It's just a copy of it. And it says there £3,750 to be paid by the 3rd of August 2010. Fortunately, the judgment did not result in payment. The court order was said firstly by an interim charging order against the shop. And then when payment still wasn't forthcoming, a final charging order was granted. After that, the payment was made and the charging order was removed. Now, I made a complaint against my barrister and the solicitor. The barrister withdrew his fee, but the solicitor insisted on payment. An ombudsman decided he should receive £1,000. Now, my view is this. I instructed the solicitor. The solicitor then presents the case to the barrister. The barrister can only present the case as he understands it. Now, they were both responsible for bringing the case on the day. The amount deemed to be paid should have been shared between them. So anyway, I contacted the shop owners and invited them to pay their part of the bill for reinstating the ceiling of the shop premises. Now, the ceiling of the shop premises is also the floor of my flat, so I was only actually asking for 50%, you know, half of what the bill actually was. Anyway, they declined to make an offer, and although there were a couple of meetings between us, no payment was forthcoming. So I issued a second claim against them. This time I decided to do everything myself. I figured that I was the one who understood the case the best, so I decided not to use a solicitor or a barrister. Just before the case was due to be heard, the shop owners decided to settle my claim. There's a photo of the cheque that I received for £4,300. One thing that did make me think was an email that Gareth sent me. Now, my legal costs were in the region of £7,000. Gareth told me, and I pasted a bit in there, his legal costs were £20,000 odd, with the legal fees and the barrister's. I've always wondered how their costs could have been so much. It doesn't make sense to me. Now, the toilet that they wanted me to reinstate was in the basement. Most of the noises that I recorded were also in that basement. And that's it. That's how we ended up in a civil court case between us. Thanks for listening. Now, I'm going to read you some of the comments. This is what other people are saying. They're genuine comments. They've been left on YouTube. If it sounds a bit slurry, it's because I'm going through the computer at the same time holding the mic in my left hand. First one. I feel like it's a gunshot followed by a woman saying justice. Next one. I thought I could hear Simon stop, the baby's dead. This is so deeply upsetting. I think you're onto something. I hope you and your wife manage to break this wide open soon. Please keep safe. I've listened to all the recordings available, and this sounds like people smuggling to me rather than a drugs factory. The printing press is probably used to make fake IDs or fake passports. The reason the police won't investigate? The high-ups in the force are probably taking backhanders for the smugglers to turn a blind eye. I wouldn't put it past them. If the police won't investigate, hire a private investigator. Then send all the evidence to us here. We'll leave that one. Next one. Oh, I like this one. I really like this one. You're a seriously clever bloke, and I want nothing to see but this operation get raided, the perpetrators put behind bars, and the victims get the support that they need to go through the trauma. Now, although I like that one, he says I'm a seriously clever bloke. I'm not. I'm an ordinary guy. I didn't pick this fight. I didn't want this fight. It's, for some reason, they've picked on me. But the thing is, it's them that's the clever ones. They've managed to ridicule me, taint the evidence all the way through this. I've been fighting this for 2 years. 2 whole years. It's them that's the clever ones. Okay, here's another one. I think there's a lot more to meet the eye, even though what does meet the eye has proven to be quite astonishing. Absolutely ridiculous. That was a bit of emphasis there, wasn't it? Absolutely ridiculous that he'd have given weeks' notice prior to a police search. More than enough time to clean the place up before using it again. There's something fishy about all this. Scroll down a little bit further. For some reason, I'm not getting my email. This happened before. I don't know what causes it. I just cannot get any email on either of the channels, the Gmail or the ProtonMail. We're aware of it. It happened last year as well. Our websites got hacked and went down, but we'll get over it. Anyway, it really sounds like the underground of the shop is being used for a resized illegal operation involving drug production and human trafficking. Really frightened that the police haven't looked into it. Hope to hear from you soon. That's an important comment. It's the underground of the shop. It's not the shop itself. Yeah, it's underneath the ground. Okay, I'm reading them as I'm going along, so... Oh, this is an interesting one. Yeah, this is about the video I put up, Rape at Gunpoint and Child Molesting. And although the lady only uses four words, she does it so well. What an absolute scumbag. Another one. The world's morals have turned upside down, Alan. It's a scary world now. Another one. Underground Railroad and trafficking kids, probably. Another one. Why the hell aren't the police listening to you? Here's one. I keep seeing you and people report it to the police, as if they need to check it out. If it's on your property, why not just venture down into the tunnel? Here's another one from Dan. Hello, Dan. Glad to see you're still active on your channel, Alan. Keep pressing on. I do believe the oppressors trapped underground. The evidence is overwhelming. Drug rings and slave labour are being discovered all the time in your area. It's no surprise it's going on in Ammanford. Dan is also the one who identified some of the gunshots. Not all of them. There's two different recordings of them. But one of them is an AK-47 firing. I was going to mention adrenochrome on your post video, and I saw this a little time. That's the worrying one. I just hope that doesn't turn out to be true, but there's an awful lot about it on the internet. And this lady says, yes, I've heard of that as well. It's frightening. There's a lot of information on Edge of Wonder about it, as there well might be, but I haven't looked at it because I find it disturbing. There's another one. It's why the world is the way it is. All the noise right down, the man-made coronavirus, BLM, and anything that can be used as brain for all the news is distractory to cover it up. I'm not going to take a view on that. The virus seems real enough to me. Yeah, the next one. Try to scroll down with my fingers. It's awkward. Oh, this was an interesting one. Someone who lives in the town said there's a water park right behind the property. Could that explain the screaming? No, it couldn't. That one particular one was taken after 11 o'clock at night, so that really rules that one out. But in any event, it was an old paddling pool that made it a splash pool for the kids. Now, from what I've seen of it, they've done quite well. I mean, if I was a kid, yeah, I'd be up for that. But it's a splash pool, and it's quite a way behind the house. In between the two is a tennis court. Now, if you were going to hear anything, you'd have heard the tennis court. But like I say, it was 11 o'clock at night, so no. This is another one. The guy says, I just posted a link, but realise you already know about the secret tunnel under Ammanford. This is almost a controversial one. There were some reports that come out that there was a tunnel that was underneath Ammanford. Yes, that's true. And then there was another report that said, but look at the date, April the 1st, April Fool's Day. And it was dismissed with that. I'm not so sure because those rumours have been around and they did have photos. It could be a spoof. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. A bit further down. Oh, this is about the wet wipes. Where I posted the one about the rubbish at the back of Sophia Nails. There's nothing I can say really about that. That's just a terrible amount. The point is this. Last time I looked through the rubbish, that was where I found those bags of white stuff that's totally unexplained now, but I still stand by it. Nobody wraps their rubbish up before they send it away. That's chemical of some sort. I'm guessing someone was meant to pick it up because they went ballistic at me afterwards. Before then, I'd taken their rubbish away and they'd smile and they were nice. In fact, they were really friendly people, but that one time they were really upset. But in with the rubbish is a load of wet wipes. I don't get this. There's not ones or two, but it's big bales of them, and they all smell really strongly of acetone, but not one of them has got any nail polish on, and that's the bit I just find really odd. And if you go into it, there's an article where the drains were actually blocked and it was wet wipes that had done it, and that was in Ammanford. You'll see it, it's on the news. Capital letters, someone has to help them, and loads of exclamation marks. Another one, how the hell have the police ignored this? Here's another one. David Powers, police aren't worth... Oh, I better not do that one. Could he be saying, don't shoot? It sounds like don't shoot to me. Like they shot something and the woman screams, don't shoot. Here's another one. Has anybody independently gone to check this out? Why isn't anything being done? What the hell is happening down there? Now, we do have supporters. They have been packed. It has been independently checked out. They have made independent recordings. They did make an independent drugs test of sorts. The kit they used is a forensic kit. That's all I can tell you, really.
This is an interesting one as well. James says, sounds like a swimming pool. I agree with him. There's many ways sound a swimming pool and a tunnel or a chamber sound the same, and it's the echo that gives it away. This guy says, screams, shout, then girl says, I don't know. Another one. This is where I say one man's instructing the other one. It's available on YouTube as an individual clip, but it's also in the 5-hour one. The guy says, this is Vietnamese, you can tell by the dialect in the cheeks. It's a very telltale sign of the language. A lot of it is in your cheeks, where Middle Eastern dialect is in your throat, resonance in the side of the mouth, etc. I thought that was a very good point. The question is this. When the name's said, they seem to be said with a haste or with worry. It makes you wonder if they're calling these people for help, being concerned for someone else, or because they're in a situation where they're concerned for them. Here's another one. But why would you be able to hear it under a house unless maybe there's a big sewer pipe that runs underneath and is cracked or broken? And there are various echoes from further down the road, like an army barracks, gun range, also a road nearby, possibly a park house for children's noises. Right, okay, I've run many experiments, yeah. I've had microphones at the front of the house, the back of the house, in the basement at the same time, and then I've compared them. I put them at the sides of the house. I've even gone as far as strapping microphones to the drains. There's two different drains at that property. Every old pipe I could find, and the two steel girders that run in between the house. Okay, on top of that, let's go through what he says. Further down the road, like an army barracks, there isn't one. Gun range, there isn't one. Road nearby, everybody can see in the picture that there's a road outside. Possibly a park. There's a park to the back, but there's a tennis court behind it. And then he says, and hence the children's noises. Yeah. At 11 o'clock, these were taken after, most of them were about after 11:30 at night. Children's noises. Army barracks, gun range. This is a small town in Wales. And this one, when was the Sean recording taken? It's worth looking into missing reports around that time for Sean, and always of spelling it. And there are lots of different ways of spelling it. It's an interesting point. Next one, am I able to visit the house? I'm really intrigued. As somebody believes in ghosts, this is really compelling recordings. Lots of people jumped on it. This is not ghosts, this is actually happening, this is me, somebody else. It needs to be stopped, or at least investigated or documented by cameras. Forensics need to go down there, ASAP, somebody else. Underground child traffic, I bet police office knows about it. I'm better paid to hush, the swamp runs very deep. This one was me. Dufford Parish Police Force have a joint scientific investigation unit available in Bridgend. Yet the police haven't stepped inside my house to investigate and refuse to take samples. A bit further down. Oh, this guy. Definitely fireworks. This has been disputed quite a bit. If it's fireworks or if it's gunshots. Now, to my mind, it doesn't make any difference. The noises shouldn't be capable of being recorded at the time of night they were recorded in the place they were recorded. However, we had a couple of opinions on this. One's a formula soldier. He says definitely an AK-47. I've fired high power rifles. I think it's more like an M16, but that's the bit. It could be, might be, might not. It doesn't really matter. We went as far as writing to Robert Maher, who's a forensic expert in this field, and his report is actually on my website. It's interesting what he says. The report is at https://gunshots.fanfogey.com. And that kind of puts it into perspective. There are two different files, three different files maybe, of different gunshots. What makes me think that they're not fireworks is this. They're over a long period of time. Most fireworks displays, yes, might go on for an hour, might go on for 2 hours, but you can hear these and they go on, they come back, and it's in a different recording. So I don't think it's fireworks. I'm not sure if it's gunshots or not. Some of them appear to be, some of them. There's an odd noise in between. Now, the odd noise in between, and Rob Mayer mentions this, isn't a semi-automatic weapon firing, because I've heard them, and it's not a bolt-action rifle being where the bolt's drawn back. So I bow to Rob Mayer's experience on that one. This guy. I'm now curious what's happened to the other guy's comments. He made a lot of interesting points. And don't ask, what do you hear, if you don't expect the majority of people to say fireworks? Here's the thing. I think you're saying I've taken somebody down. Now, That is possible. Anybody that names a person, or puts their name up, where they can identify, will be taken down. Anybody that I think is in any danger from what they've said will be taken down. An interesting one was, well, I don't know if anybody saw it or not. A certain person who's foreign put a translation up actually on YouTube. I thought that was dangerous, so I did take their posts down. Now, here's the thing. And don't ask what you hear if you don't expect the majority of people to say fireworks. Don't think people are saying it's fireworks. So here's another interesting one. So you're saying that police cars and cars, motorbikes are down in the hidden tunnels. I don't think I ever actually said that. On some of the recordings you can hear motorbikes in the tunnels. Now, the tunnels that went from Betty's Mountain, and I'm not saying it is that particular tunnel, but you could get a train down it. There was 2.5 miles of road, literal road, laid down in that mine. So getting a motorbike in it isn't, you know, not unbelievable at all. I'm not saying anything about police cars or cars being down there. What I was saying is there was a siren that sounded like a police car being heard. Now, lots of people have come forward and said that the siren, it's actually a recording, and it's masking other sounds of screaming and things like that. I don't know. I just want the investigation. Another one says strange. Next one down. Can you give me exact coordinates of the house? I want to have a look at the terrain. I'm willing to share the raw audio files with me. I'd like to clean up the noise and see if I can help isolate the sounds. Yes, absolutely. Anybody that wants the raw audio sound noise is welcome to them. I could do with all the help I get. I fully accept I'm an amateur in this field. I don't know what I'm doing, although this mic is quite good. Next guy simply says sick. Next one says terror. This one says, you say gunshots, I say fireworks, lots of laughs. Next one says, what drugs do you reckon are being made there? I don't know. I am not an expert. I haven't got a clue. Two tests were done. The details are on the website. There are forensic kits. They seem to test positive for MDMA. Somebody said, could it be cannabis? I don't think it could be cannabis because of the automated machines and the toxic chemicals that came out into the drains. But that's just my opinion. Like I say, I'm not an expert. The next one says, is there any way into the tunnels below? I put a video up about that. I've emailed you and you haven't bothered replying. Lots of laughs. Well, I haven't been getting emails, I don't know why, but I would like people to get in touch with their ideas. It sounds like she's saying the ladies died. That's what I'm hearing her say. Wow, it's just gone screams, I've done that. Well, that's some terrifying screams going on there. I've listened to this twice now, and the second time I heard the other screams. I'll be listening to some more again later. If this is true, then I can't blame you for, you know, leaving there with all this going on. If other people have heard these noises, so they can't be fake. Those are children screaming. Why is nobody helping them? Did I hear a guy speak Spanish around the 1 minute mark? He said, extra seguro, and Simon laughed. No, okay, my pronunciation's not probably very good, but I did translate it, and it means, are you sure? Sounds like, why did you watch the baby die? I'm game for everything, but be careful. This is a copy and paste from UK solicitor. This is a guy advising me on law, for which I thank him. Yes, I have recorded people without their permission. Yeah, I get that one. It was inside my house, inside the basement of the floor. If those people would like to come forward, you know, and explain what they're doing there, that'd be great. Bring it on. Stop, get back. That's what I hear. This was somebody asking about the questions. Whether the court case that the Vietnamese people were in were before or after the last recordings. Now, the court case was September 2019. The last recordings were made 22nd of December 2020. So at that point, yes, it's still got... That's wrong. The court case was September 2019. There's a typo in that one. The last recordings were made the 22nd of December 2019. So yes, it is still going on. Or it was then. Thank you very much for your reply. It's so gut-wrenching. It sounds like someone doesn't want you to see anything. Now, this is a reference to the CCTV cameras that I put up. Then they got sabotaged, so I put them up again, then they got sabotaged again. I think I'd learn by now, wouldn't you? This one says, I've listened to both your recordings. Have you seen the comments left by Jane Edwards joining in the comments section of Panwell Radio Interview 321? You need to check them out. The recordings of younger children screaming. Or Defo don't think they're playing. This is Jane Edwards Johns. I think you've all probably seen the video. It's the lady who owns the shop. After the interview I did, Me and Ben were talking about human trafficking, kids screaming and crying, toxic chemicals being flushed down the drain underneath the floor of this lady's property, which she is actually the owner of Sophia Nails. And she actually left a comment for me, said, there are many, what was it she said? There are many irregularities in Mr. Tait's interview. Now it struck me as strange. Wouldn't you think you'd be concerned? I mean, if it was my shop, I'd be going, what's going on? You know, talking about it, discussing it, trying to help, trying to get the police involved. But no. And if you're listening, Jane, Ben's invited you on the show, so if you want to give your point of view, that's fine. If you want to get in touch with me and give us your point of view, I'll put it on YouTube so everybody can see it. Thanks. This is another one, and it comes from the Hapanra Radio, the human screaming one. The guy says, I agree with the speaker. There's no way those noises are coming from a school. And remember the time of day, so, I mean, they're not coming from a school because it's late at night. If you listen carefully, you can hear the words, Konnichiwa, said twice. Somebody else says, that's Japanese Konnichiwa. And I agree, it does sound like the word Konnichiwa, which is Japanese. However, Konnichiwa in Japanese means hello. And it doesn't seem to fit in with the distress that is in that person's voice. There's another one. It sounds to me like the man's in extreme pain. I've listened with headphones and there are two different screams, I think. Number one is the man, the loudest scream, and the second one sounds like a woman. I played it again. There does seem to be two screams in that one. There's another one. To me, it sounds like normal traffic and people in their area going about their everyday lives. There's another one. Well, it looks now like you know where the noises are truly coming from. Most likely the stairs or entryway is through the basement of Sophia's. That's not likely simply because I know the shop. At the front of the shop there is a basement, but at the back of the shop there isn't. And the noises are coming more towards the back than they are the front.